Okay, if I could encourage those leaving the public gallery to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible as we move on to the final item of business, which is a member's business debate on motion 12540 in the name of Richard Leonard on supporting the further education workforce. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Richard Leonard to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr Leonard.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I begin by thanking members from across all parties for supporting tonight's motion? And can I welcome EIS members to the public gallery? The EIS has just finished its rolling programme of one-day strikes, but it has not finished its dispute. In fact, industrial action is going to escalate to go national and move to 2 days, to 3 days, to 4 days. When I speak to EIS members on the picket line or when they come through to Edinburgh to lobby this Parliament, they tell me to ask the Minister, why is there a flat cash settlement for further education leading to cuts in courses, cuts in student places, cuts in lecturer numbers? And it is no good the Minister telling us to use the gross domestic product deflator rather than the consumer prices index to calculate the huge real terms financial deficit which our colleges face at the hands of this government. Whichever way he defines it, however he cuts it, it represents a clear drop in resources and a massive rise in the deficit. And it's no good either the Minister asking us where we would make the cuts instead. We are not in the business of making cuts. Although I would cut all public funds to all Scotland's arms manufacturers who are selling to the Israeli government to bomb the people of Gaza. The government is in charge of a £50 billion budget. There is COVID money in the system, still unaccounted for. There was a £500 million underspend last year. It's no good the Minister asking where will the money come from. He is the Government Minister in a Government which can find money when it wants to. It does not have a fixed budget. It can raise revenue. And beyond all of this, education is in any case an investment. So to the Government, we say that if you think education is expensive, try ignorance. Those EIS members I speak to also say, ask him why the employers are not negotiating. And they say, ask him why he will not step in to resolve the impasse and so resolve the dispute. Ask him why it is that college principals cannot attend a meeting to end the pay dispute, but can turn up in numbers to attend a meeting to discuss deeming. In his resignation speech just last week, the former First Minister warned that it is often the most marginalised in society who bear the brunt. And he is right. But let me tell the new First Minister and the Minister for Veterans and Higher and Further Education that these cuts to further education funding will mean cuts to student places, and they will be cuts to student places for the most disaffected, for the most disengaged, for the most marginalised in society. And for some of those students, it will mean the difference between engagement with the education system or being driven to social disengagement and isolation at home. For others, again, it will mean the difference between engagement with the education system or engagement with the criminal justice system. That's the difference it will make. Presiding Officer, people do not live individually in a market. We all live in a society, in a community, where we look out for each other. Further education colleges provide huge community benefit. They are part of our social infrastructure as well as our economic future. I firmly believe in the idea that, in the words of Eugene Debs, full opportunity for full development is an unalienable right of all. That's what this debate is about. It's about whether people get the chance or not, whether further education expands or contracts, whether opportunities expand or contract, and it's about whether we value the people who make those opportunities possible.
Paul Sweeney.
I thank my friend for giving way. He's making a typically powerful speech. I thank my friend for giving way. He's making a typically powerful speech. Does he not agree with me that this spiral of decline is most tragic because our industries in Scotland are crying out for the skills, yet the colleges aren't being given the investment to respond to that need from our industries?
Richard Leonard.
Absolutely, because in my view, we need lifelong learning so that everyone can realise their full potential. And that is economically, but it is also socially, personally, spiritually even. And, you know, one of the problems that we face is that too often our education system is built on the premise that if at first you don't succeed, you don't succeed. People deserve a second chance, and that's what further education and training is about. So I say to the Minister tonight that there is nothing more corrupting in politics than remaining inactive, for feigning impotence. What the government is doing on this lecturer's pay dispute is not even second rate, it is non-existent. We are sent here to represent the aspirations of the people who elect us. Change will not come about by waiting around. It demands vigour, ingenuity, determination, and we see none of that from this government. All we see instead is obstinacy, complacency, mediocrity. And when the government speaks, we hear the voice of an SNP minister, but the ideology of a fiscal conservative. What about our educational tradition? What about our democratic tradition? What about our radical tradition? We cannot have another year of unrest in our colleges. The minister has the duty and he has the power to get it sorted out. This would not be about surrendering your authority. It would be about exercising your authority. This requires government intervention. It demands renewed political leadership. And that is what all sides of this parliament are urging the government to show us this afternoon.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate. I call first Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Up to 4 minutes, Mr MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank Richard Leonard for bringing the motion to the chamber. I'll say at the outset that my interest to speak in this debate is mainly driven through a constituency interest in having very much over the years a lot of contact from constituents on this issue. And I'd also like to put on record my thanks to union officials such as Eileen Imler and Angela McCormack in my constituency for the work that they have done around this area. And I know that Richard Leonard also has had regular contact with them. In fact, we have a bit of a joke about it that they come to see me at a constituency surgery every year as these issues come up again. And I'd also like to take the opportunity to thank them for the recent event that they had in Parliament that I know that many members across the chamber went to. And as I said, the issue comes up every year, and it strikes me that we say that almost every year since I've been elected in 2016, that Eileen, Angela and others have come to my constituency office to talk about issues around pay. And it strikes me that there's a real breakdown somewhere in communication between the workers and the lecturers and the unions as a whole and those who run the colleges. And I think that, you know, it's maybe not, I don't fully maybe agree with where Richard Leonard was coming, it's for the government to come in and sort out. I maybe don't go quite as far as that, but there surely needs to be something done here to improve this communication between the colleges and the lecturers. I can see Monica wanting to come in. Is this how the new system works? Yeah. Okay.
No Monica Lennon.
Grateful to Philip McGregor for giving way, and I think he has been very generous with his time to constituents and FE workers. But Does he not agree that this is not a communication problem? This is a political problem. Governments make political choices. They're making the wrong ones. Can't we all work together to make sure that we get the minister to do something today, finally? Because 8 years is a very long time.
Fulton MacGregor, and give the time back.
I thank Monica Lennon for that intervention. I'm not disagreeing with the premise that she's saying there, because you can say that everything is a political problem. And I have already said that I do think some intervention is required to bring about some sort of solution to this issue. What I'm saying is I don't think it would be the government's job as such to you know, negotiate the pay element of it. I think that the Funding Council and others should be doing that, but there's definitely something breaking down because, you know, every single year people are coming to see their MSPs and other representatives about this issue, so there must be something there that needs to be sorted out. And where I would agree with Monica Lennon, if the Minister doesn't mind me saying, I do think that if the Scottish Government could possibly be more involved in trying to identify where the issues are and trying to bring it to some sort of solution, because every year the same issues are there. Because as we joked about the people coming to the, and it's not a joke, but as we joked about people coming to constituency offices every year to come to surgeries, there's also the strikes every year as well. And I've been at the picket lines as well, as I know that Monica and Richard have, and I know that other colleagues from the SNP have also attended picket lines. So, you know, we don't want to be in that position every year as well. That's absolutely clear. You know, one of the other things that I did want to mention that Richard Leonard did mention in the motion was a tactic which has been reported to me, and I'm not sure the full ins and outs of it, but certainly Eileen Imlay and Angela McCormack have reported to me that that some colleges are threatening to not pay for action that is short of strike action from lecturers. I don't believe that is acceptable, if I'm understanding it the way it's been put to me, because I do fully believe in the rights of all workers and all organisations to strike and should not have that threat hanging over them. Presiding Officer, I do just want to finish by saying that I believe that colleges and their lecturers across Scotland do an absolutely excellent job. I cover Coatbridge and Christen, and proudly within my constituency is the Coatbridge campus of New College, Lanarkshire, an absolutely fantastic facility which I've visited on numerous occasions to hear about some of the great work and innovative work that they're doing. And this all couldn't happen without the lecturers who put their full commitment in. So I know that this is a very... I also should say that it's a very... my constituency is a particularly impoverished part of the country, and it's very important that people, particularly young people, have the opportunities to go to further education in the Coatbridge campus, as well as other campuses of New College Lanarkshire. Certainly provide that. Presiding Officer, I'll just finish by saying I know this is a very complicated issue. Do not envy the Minister's position here at all. It is very difficult, but I do think the Government have probably taken an approach of it's for other people to sort out. And perhaps what's been asked today is if the Government could somehow be involved
to try and
bring even people together to sort it out and find some sort of solution. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Graeme Simpson around 4 minutes. Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank my colleague and friend Richard Leonard for bringing this important debate to the Chamber tonight. Colleges are the engines of our future. They sit at the heart of opportunity for all, and they are responsible for skilling Scotland's young people of today and of tomorrow. Not only are they key to widening access, but they are also the embodiment of it. Among 250,000 students of this year's college students, more than 40% are over 25. A third come from the most deprived areas of the country. 15% are disabled, 17,000 are black and ethnic minority, and 3,000 are care experienced. They are not just the engines of our future, they are the engines of our collective efforts to meet the aims of the promise and to make Scotland a land of opportunity for all. And I see this every day in the great work of colleges up and down the country and in the Glasgow region that I represent. And I want to say thank you to each and every student and member of staff that I have met for continuing to do all you can to deliver for education and for communities. I've said this many times before in this chamber, and I'll say it again. Colleges really are key to breaking the glass, class and step ceiling. And that's why I'm so determined that colleges get the changes they need. But to do that, if you want high and rising standards in education, you have to invest in staff. You have to invest in their terms and conditions and in their professionalism. For too long, college staff have felt that this government has not given them that or the support that they need. In evidence to the Audit Committee last year, EIS Fila said, in other areas of the education system, such as schools, the need to invest in staff seems to be accepted. However, that's never been accepted in the college sector in the same sort of language, which is disappointing. For the umpteenth year in a row now, college staff have had to take to picket lines across the country because they're seeing their colleges struggle, courses dropped, their pay lose value, and they face redundancy. Presiding Officer, job losses mean cuts in educational opportunities for students. And as EIS also said in that committee session, cuts to provision are happening. And the areas that are cut first are the community learning and provision for additional support needs. That's how it works. That is what happens. The most vulnerable people in society are the ones who are losing out as a result of the cuts. Michael, right when they need them the most, the government is delivering less for colleges and the most vulnerable people in our country. Yes, I will.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Pam Duncan-Glancy to take an intervention, but is it also not right that it is in fact the students, it is in fact those who are using colleges that are standing behind their lecturers because they understand the importance of settling this dispute so that they can break the glass ceiling, they can break the step ceiling and they can move on?
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank my colleague for that intervention and he is of course absolutely correct. That is the case. Students have stood shoulder to shoulder, rightly, with their staff on the picket lines because they know that it is staff and students together who make colleges and communities. When I tried to raise the gravity of all of this with the Minister, he demanded that I provide answers. And I cannot hide my frustration at that. He is the government, and it is his failure to act that demonstrates a complete dereliction of duty. College staff are stuck in a perpetual strike action because the Minister has failed to take the reins and offer a fair deal. They've been striking for nearly a decade, with more to come, and it seems there's no end in sight. Some college staff have felt compelled to stop marking in a desperate attempt to catch this government's attention. And in response, colleges feel so strongly that students deserve to be graded that they've taken extreme action and disproportionately docked wages. A failure to act to this end by this government is tantamount to implementing anti-trade union rules and minimum service level agreement that this government rightly criticises the Tories for. And college principals, they're struggling in despair too. Their students might not get their grades, their staff are striking for better paying conditions, and they have rising costs to heat and fix their buildings, and their student support budget is to be slashed. The Minister's inaction has allowed internal college tensions to grow and industrial relations to descend into a war of attrition. And if all that isn't enough, there are warnings that four colleges might not exist at the end of the year. Deputy Presiding Officer, it's become so bad that college lecturers are now saying that the Minister is the invisible man. So on behalf of college lecturers, I ask him today, does he accept staff calls for pay in line with public sector pay and that colleges need help to deliver that? Will he show leadership and deliver an emergency funding package to help colleges with voluntary redundancy schemes? Will he fix the flawed national machinery that's meant to govern all of this? Will the Minister step up and step in, take responsibility, stop expecting others to provide him the answers to the crisis that 17 years of his government has created? Students and staff need this government's help. Enough is enough. Let's get colleges back on track, support them to be the engine rooms of our future. We all know they can be, spreading opportunity for all. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Duncan-Glancy. I now call Graham Simpson to be followed by Carol Mock in around 4 minutes. Mr Simpson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I congratulate Richard Leonard for securing enough support to be able to debate this important issue today? I actually think I got him over the line by being the only Conservative to sign his motion. But of course, we're using our parliamentary debating time tomorrow to debate it again. And it's such a worthy topic. Now, I've got a very good relationship with my local EIS feeler reps. I've had that for a long time now. They include those representing staff at South Lanarkshire College and New College Lanarkshire, who I also get to see regularly, not just once a year. We have liaised on a number of issues, some of which are ongoing, but what always comes up is the dire straits the sector is in. Now, Richard Leonard's motion focuses on the current pay dispute, and I've got huge sympathy with the EIS feeler members who feel compelled to strike every single year. And college bosses, who can be fantastically well paid, should be on the same side as their staff, who should not be having to wait for what Richard Leonard describes as an acceptable offer for longer than 18 months. These devoted public servants have bills to pay and are not paid a king's ransom. Now, Richard Leonard and I sit on the Public Audit Committee, and we carried out an inquiry into the college sector on the back of a very worrying report from the Auditor General. All the issues we looked at are, in fact, linked to the current pay dispute. It all comes down to money in the end, and the sector has been starved of it. I'd say, respectfully to Fulton MacGregor, this is not a communications issue. It comes down to resources and lack of them. The Herald ran a week-long series about colleges last week, and they concluded that over 3 years, there's been a funding gap of £464 million. That's the figure you're left with if funding had kept pace with inflation compared to what has actually been given. Now, Graham Day may dispute the figure, but he admits there is a gap, and he must surely admit there is a problem. Prior to the Public Audit Committee inquiry, I'd heard that the Scottish Funding Council kept a list of those colleges that are in the bleakest financial state, and I was told there was a colour coding system with these colleges coded black. Now, when Karen Watt, the boss of the Funding Council, appeared before us in January, she revealed that there were four colleges facing what she called significant cash flow issues. They were and are in dire financial straits. Now, I don't know which colleges they were because she wouldn't tell us, but the fact that they exist should be a badge of shame for the Minister and his many predecessors, and I hope he's taking a note of this as he writes. We repeatedly heard that colleges are having to look at cutting courses, cutting staff, and skimping on maintenance. In November, Derek Smeal, the principal of Glasgow Kelvin College, who was representing the College Principals Group, told us, "Colleges and the college sector, as they are just now, are certainly not sustainable." In his own college, he was predicting a deficit for the year 22-23 of £1.3 million. And he said, "In 22-23, I've already released 6.5% of my workforce, and over each of the next 2 years, I will release a similar amount." His story was typical of that heard throughout the sector. The Herald shone a light on the value of our college sector. Universities get more of the limelight and more of the funding, but you could argue that colleges and their courses have more value. We need to invest in them better. Now, the Minister will close with some warm words. He needs to close with action. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. I now call Carol Mochan to be followed by Ross Greer in 4 minutes. Ms. Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by thanking my colleague Richard Leonard for bringing this very important debate to the Chamber and pay tribute to members of EIS FILA who are fighting passionately for pay and conditions that reflect the work they do in the further education sector. Further education lecturers make up a skilled and dedicated workforce, and they have my full support and solidarity as we continue to stand with them on the picket lines and stand up for them in this Parliament. And I'd like to make the point that I think it is the responsibility of us in the opposition benches and of the back benches to make this point, that this is a fair fight that we should be bringing to this Parliament, to the Minister. I have stood side by side with further education lecturers and other staff at Ayrshire College, and the overwhelming feeling expressed is one of being undervalued. So we can talk about valuing these staff, but actually the sector needs action, and it needs us on these benches and on the government's own backbenches to talk about the action that this government can take. Our further education workforce teach key skills. They set up people for a life in skilled employment. They are experts in their individual fields, and they choose to dedicate their lives to improving the outcomes of others. Yet still, College of Scotland and the Scottish Government cannot bring themselves to recognise that value. As the motion states, the current offer on the table represents a real-terms pay reduction. This means that whilst colleges are being underfunded by the Scottish Government, we've heard, and cutbacks are being felt across the country, College of Scotland is doubling down and making an insulting offer to these lecturers. Presiding Officer, further education lecturers have been forced into industrial action. Action short of a strike was not met with an acceptable response, and in some cases, actions from management and colleges has fallen well short of the expectations set out within the Fair Work framework, and I think the Minister in his response should reference these matters. It's nothing short of appalling that our lecturers are being treated in this way. They do not deserve to have to go through such a gruelling battle simply to see their pay and conditions reflect the very valuable work that they do. And they deserve so much better, and they will continue to have the support of these benches. Turning briefly to students, Presiding Officer, I wish to put on record my thanks to all the students who have come out in support of the action taken by their lecturers. In a time where attempts have been made to pit students against lecturers, it has been truly heartening to see so many students stand with their lecturers, recognise the importance and indeed the importance of the action that they are taking. This is such an important sector to ordinary working people, and they recognise this. The Minister will not like to hear this, but my colleague mentioned that he is often described as the missing man, and he must do better. I can say to him today, these workers will not stop their fight for better pay and conditions, and the trade union movement will not be deterred by a lack of cooperation from this Scottish Government. This will merely intensify efforts, and I urge the Minister to get key stakeholders around the table and intervene. The reality is that the ask of further education lecturers is not an unreasonable one. The work they do is invaluable, and the impact their efforts have on improving skills, supporting employment opportunities, growing the economy and delivering positive outcomes for those in areas that need it most cannot go unnoticed and unrewarded. The Minister must act. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. I now call Ross Greer to be followed by Colin Smith. Around 4 minutes, Mr Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And like colleagues, can I thank and congratulate Richard Leonard for bringing the debate to the Chamber this afternoon. I think it's been about 18 months since I last brought members' business on the industrial action, the chronic challenges in industrial action that we see in Scotland's college sector. The Scottish Greens absolutely believe that colleges have a critical role to play in building a fairer, greener Scotland, and on delivering the key priorities that we can all agree on, like the climate action required to reach our net zero targets, the eradication of child poverty, the First Minister has just reaffirmed as his priority for his new government this afternoon. Education is both a social and an individual good. It can be genuinely transformational for people's lives. Now, we shouldn't pretend that a good education can simply undo all the structural inequalities that we face in society. That places far too much burden, whether it be on teachers or college or university lecturers. But it is a key ingredient to a successful society. And by success, I'm not just talking about a society who defines its success by GDP wealth or even by average incomes, though that is an important measure. But a successful society is one that is collectively able to meet the needs of every individual and to give all the opportunity of a happy, healthy life. The ability of colleges to do that, to play their critical role, has been hugely held back over the last decade by chronic problems in industrial relations. And I think it is a clear example of class inequality that this has gone on for so long with so little attention relative to the much shorter bouts of industrial action that we've seen in schools and in universities that have garnered far, far more political and media attention. But what would the Scottish Greens do differently? How do we believe that we can break out of this cycle? For a start, we would apply far stricter fair work conditions on the funding of colleges, policies like the elimination of zero-hours contracts and the implementation of pay ratios, to demonstrate, particularly to the lowest paid college staff and to support staff, that efforts are being made to improve their conditions. We want to see far more enforcement of fair work conditions, whether it be those national conditions that we would like to see the SFC set out, or local fair work agreements reached between college management and unions on an individual college basis. The funding conditions of Funding Council's evaluation of this element of the outcome agreements seems frankly to be almost non-existent. Fair work policies are worthless if they are not actually being enforced by the body with the power to do so, the body that controls the purse strings. I'm proud of the fact that college boards must now include at least two trade union representatives. That was something delivered by the Scottish Greens in our time in government. But I believe college governance requires far more strengthening than that. I think consideration should be given to the appointment, for example, of reserved spaces for local councillors, ensuring there's a stronger connection between colleges and the communities that they're in, and better coordination between colleges and councils, two bodies that are obviously key towards for local economic development. We also need to address issues where individual boards are not providing sufficient scrutiny. I think we've clearly seen that at City of Glasgow College, where the proximity of the senior management and the board, particularly the chair, has been corrosive for effective scrutiny and the confidence of the workforce. And it is hard for staff to stomach lectures on fiscal constraints from principals who are paid more than the First Minister. So I think what we need to see is college principals brought into the public sector pay strategy, particularly the chief executive pay framework. I think the Scottish Government needs to respond to the recommendations in the Strathess Lessons Learned report. If we're to break out of this cycle, we need to acknowledge that all sides will need to come out of their comfort zone and consider recommendations that may not be their preferences, but that would provide something of a route forward. And I do want to see the restoration of the £26 million that was initially allocated by the Greens for transformation in our college sector. I understand why it was reallocated. It was to fulfil the needs of the teacher pay deal that I was involved with, so I absolutely recognise that, but that money absolutely needs to go back into our college sector. I don't think it's good enough to simply demand more for MSPs from parties who voted against increasing tax on the top 5% to mitigate cuts. I think it is incumbent on all parties in this place, particularly now that we've entered a period of minority government, to come forward with credible tax and spend proposals. I absolutely want to see more funding for our college sector. My party is prepared to detail where we would get that from. I think for the sake of college staff, students and wider society, it's incumbent on all parties, all MSPs, to bring forward credible proposals at the upcoming round of budget negotiations so we can play our part in breaking this cycle.
Thank you, Mr Greer. I now call Colin Smith to be followed by Monica Lennon, around 4 minutes. Mr Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you to my colleague Richard Leonard for tabling his motion. Once again, Presiding Officer, it's left to opposition parties to bring forward for debate the important issues facing our college sector. Ministers are quick to come to this chamber to claim junior doctors aren't on strike in Scotland because of government intervention, or to say that the teachers' dispute was resolved because of the actions of ministers. Yet when it comes to this dispute, when it comes to our colleges, there's been no meaningful intervention. Ministers have been posted missing. It was 2021 when our college lecturers last had a pay deal. I've lost count of the number of picket lines I've stood on since then, listening to college staff. Not a single lecturer on those picket lines has wanted to be there. Not a single lecturer has wanted to be anywhere other than teaching their students. But they're scunnered 3 years on, 3 years since that last pay rise. They're tired of being offered real terms pay cuts, worn out by threats of deeming and compulsory redundancies, sickened by being told their pay deals can only be funded by the loss of their colleagues' jobs. Those lecturers that the Minister needs to understand, however, are in absolutely no doubt that they are determined to keep fighting, to keep standing on those picket lines until they're listened to by this government. And rightly so, because their demands, as Carol Mochan has said, are not unreasonable. Crucially, they're flexible. The cost of resolving this dispute, of getting people back to work, of ending the disruption to our students, would be a fraction of the cost of those disputes the government have already intervened in. The fact ministers are posted missing tells you all you need to know about the lack of priority the SNP and the Greens have given to our colleges. I listened to what Ross Grier had to say. You would be forgiven for thinking Green MSPs hadn't voted for the biggest cuts to colleges since devolution. Our colleges should be the powerhouse. I'll take an intervention, yep.
Ross Grier, sir.
I'm grateful to Mr Smith for taking the intervention. His colleague Richard Leonard said that the Labour Party wasn't in the business of proposing its own cuts. Can I ask why then every Labour MSP, every one of these socialists, voted against increasing tax on the top 5% so that we could mitigate cuts to public services?
The reality is that Ross Grier did not mitigate the cuts to colleges. He voted for the cuts to colleges. That's why we've got a dispute in place at the moment, and the buck stops with the Greens and SNP MSPs. It's your budget. Take responsibility, Mr Grier. Our colleges should be a powerhouse of our economy, something that Ross Grier and the Greens failed to accept, and they should be there to deliver the skills at every single stage of the learning journey. New qualifications for school leavers, upskilling, retraining those in the workplace. Every single week I speak to local businesses about the labour skills and the shortages they face. Yet at the same time I speak to my local colleges who tell me they are having to axe apprenticeship places, remove courses, make staff redundant because of the brutal cuts to college budgets year after year after year, voted for by Green and SNP MSPs. It was bad enough that our colleges saw an 8.5% real terms cut from 2021 to 2023. But it's utterly indefensible. The most recent budget will see a further 8% cut this year, not because of a lack of demand from students or employers, but because of a lack of priority given to colleges by the SNP Green government. Construction firms, engineering firms in Dumfries and Galloway tell me they're crying out for skilled workers in the region. But a £1 million cut in the local college budget this year will mean we now have a waiting list for courses in these crucial roles. Young people, often from our most deprived communities, are having their chances to get on cruelly snatched from them by the choices of this government. In businesses, often small firms, and rural areas where we have a crisis of outward migration of young people are having the opportunities to grow, to create jobs, scuppered because of the short-sightedness of ministers. It is, Presiding Officer, the economics of the madhouse. So now that the music has stopped in the merry-go-round of First Ministers, I'd make this direct appeal to John Swinney. Show some leadership and direction from this failing government. Stop hiding behind Colleges Scotland and the Funding Council. Get round the table with our colleges and unions. Find the resources to give our lecturers a fair pay deal. End this dispute now and get our lecturers and students back where they want to be, and that's in the classrooms.
Thank you, Mr Smith. I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Monica Lennon, in around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I join colleagues in thanking and congratulating my colleague Richard Leonard for securing this debate, but also for his very passionate speech, which from where I was sitting sounded like a real call to action amidst this ongoing and escalating industrial action in our vital further education sector. And I would say to colleagues, if they are getting fed up having to go along to picket lines and listen to members from EIS Fila, think what it must be like for those members who are having to sacrifice pay and are feeling at times that they're letting down their students, but as we've heard, the students have their back. So if we are fed up with it, think what it must be like for them. But many of us have and continue to go out on those picket lines. For myself, recently that's been the Motherwell campus of New College Lanarkshire, up in East Kilbride for South Lanarkshire College. But I also see those same faces when I do regular visits, or recently when I was at the graduation ceremony for South Lanarkshire College. And in that setting in Hamilton Townhouse, where I was on the stage and could see everything that was happening, you could really see the relationships, the connection, the love between the lecturers and FE staff and their students. And as others have said, it's not just about further education giving people their first chance or even their second chance. It's about the lifelong opportunities that people need to lead happy and fulfilled lives. But it's also about our economy, absolutely about our economy. and skills and about making sure that we function and progress as a society. So I'm not surprised when I hear employers in my region of Central Scotland champion our local colleges. It's why I was pleased to sponsor an event in the Garden Lobby just recently to shine a light on Apprenticeship Week and to hear from the employers and the apprentices and everyone in our community who sees the value in that. When I sit every week, as I do on the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, I hear about the importance of skills, about training, about the need to properly have community wealth building and to get that just transition. Everything comes back to further education and skills. I wanted to just mention some of the people behind these issues that we're debating today. So, you know, I'm grateful to Fulton MacGregor for reminding us how long these debates and disputes have been going on for. But when I was at New College Lanarkshire just a couple of weeks ago, I was able to catch up with Gabriel, who's one of the lecturers there, and he's been out on the picket line for 8 years. And I think for about 7 of those years, his young son, Julio, has been on the picket line with him. They've recently made a video. I'm not sure if ES Fila members have put that online yet, but I would appeal to everyone to watch it, because you're watching a wee boy in this video whose childhood, you know, is passing by, and here we are. And, you know, to hear, you know, colleagues suggest that, well, maybe it's just too complex, I would say, if there are ministers or people in positions of power who are finding it just too hard, well, there might be a reshuffle happening tomorrow. Offer your resignation. But what I would say to whoever is in charge of this, do not walk on by. Do not walk away. Do not shut your door. A couple of weeks ago, ES Fila members were in here. They were in a room off the Garden Lobby. And I witnessed, I have to say, with regret, I witnessed the minister walk on by when people had turned up to say, come and chat to us. We are here. Really, we're here to find solutions. So whether you're the minister or you're a backbench MSP, we all have a duty to find those solutions. I'm glad we're having this debate today. There'll be another debate tomorrow, but the time for talking surely must come to an end. We need to see action.
Thank you, Ms Lennon. I now call Graeme Day to respond to the debate, Minister, around 7 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also want to thank Richard Leonard for tabling this debate, and to members for their contributions, because the issues that have been raised across the Chamber are important. I want to acknowledge the contribution that all staff engaged in Scotland's college sector make, from lecturers delivering teaching and equipping learners from all backgrounds with the skills they require to flourish, to the staff keeping buildings open and campuses safe. Each and every one of them contribute to the college sector in Scotland. And I say that noting that the motion before us strangely makes no mention of the support staff, who for me are every bit as important in all of this. Presiding Officer, what the motion essentially is looking for is the Scottish Government to find from somewhere in the education or wider government budget monies to give to colleges to go beyond the present offer and satisfy the expectations of ES Fila. Now, I have every respect for Mr Leonard. He is consistent in his view of trade union pay expectations and the need to meet them. But I have to say to him, the government is in no position financially to do that. And just as importantly, the Strathesque report was clear that the Scottish Government intervention previously in industrial disputes in this sector have not been helpful. It is for college employers and trade unions. No, I won't. Sorry, I've heard quite a lot from the other side of this. I wanted to put an alternative view, but also to pick up on some of the legitimate points that members have made. It is for college employers and trade unions to negotiate a settlement. It's not for the Scottish Government. Our intervention would fundamentally alter the nature of the voluntary national bargaining process. Now, what government can do is seek to encourage the employers and unions, actively encourage, to find a resolution, to try and facilitate an improvement in the more general approach to interaction between them. And I'm going to return to that point later, because as Fulton MacGregor highlighted, it is important. I meet both sides regularly through various forums. In fact, tomorrow I was to be meeting with both College of Scotland and then separately the sector chairs. Those engagements would absolutely have touched on the need to seek an outcome to the industrial action in the sector. Unfortunately, the scheduling Conservative business will prevent that from happening. But throughout that engagement, I continue to make it clear that I expect both sides to work collaboratively to reach a settlement that is affordable and fair. Indeed, it was at my suggestion they moved on to considering a three-year agreement, in the belief that might give the sector some respite from the industrial strife of the past decade. I'm aware that at formal meetings of the National Joint Negotiation Committee in March, both sides agreed to continue informal discussions with a view to seeking a resolution to this dispute. Following those informal discussions, I understand the employers met today and have agreed a revised three-year offer to take to support staff trade unions. This includes further proposed wording in regards to job security, and it will be discussed in full at an NJNC meeting in the coming days. I also understand a date is due to be agreed in the coming days to allow further formal discussions to take place between EIS FIWA and CES. I want to take the opportunity to acknowledge the proactive willingness of Unison to find a solution and the efforts of the management negotiating team to bring us to this point. Between them, I think they've demonstrated that where the collective will is there, we can get progress. And let's not forget that Unite and the GMB had already reached agreement. I'm keen to see a deal which would see some of our least well-off staff in the sector secure a £5,000 boost to their pay packets concluded, with others to follow. So let's see the progress made with the support staff replicated with the teaching staff. Presiding Officer, the budgetary circumstances we all find ourselves in are not ideal. I'll give way to Graeme Simpson.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for taking the intervention? It seems to me, he seems to be saying that other unions have reached agreement, EIS FILA have not. Is he suggesting that EIS FILA are being too greedy in all this on behalf of their members?
Minister.
What I'm suggesting, Mr Simpson, is that if we can get a proactive willingness to agree to engage on this, we can begin to make progress, further progress. That's what I'm suggesting needs to happen. And to be fair, behind the scenes, there has been dialogue going on. The budgetary circumstances we all find ourselves in are not ideal. The government's financial position is the most challenging since devolution, and colleges, as a consequence, are not as well placed financially as I would want them to be. And opposition politicians, I have to say, Presiding Officer, had the chance during the budget process to bring forward alternative proposals and sat on their hands. And of course, they want more money, not just for colleges, but for universities, for student support, for apprenticeships, and so on. And yet, they voted against tax increases. Now, whilst I'm pleased to hear that this ongoing dialogue has continued, and that the resolution of the support staff dispute, it seems, is in our sights, I share the concerns of many across the Chamber about the impact that continued strike action has on students. Every student in Scotland deserves the qualifications they've worked hard to achieve, and colleges, whilst needing to get back around the table, also need to put mitigations in place. In terms of the points raised about colleges deducting pay for action short of strike, I'd expect any employer to carefully consider its position before taking such action. I understand, however, that all colleges have taken individual legal advice which set out that they are within their rights to consider such action. I also understand that EIS FIWA has acknowledged that in the advice it's given its own members. It's clear, though, that further industrial action is in no one's interest, least of all students. And while I absolutely respect the right of trade unions to take industrial action, I think we'd all agree we'd rather a settlement was reached without impacts being felt. So I hope the progress we're seeing in the support staff space can be replicated in that of the lecturers. But I reiterate that any settlement must be affordable for the sector. It is simply unrealistic to suggest affordability can be discounted, or that the government can magic up additional sums of money. I've already acknowledged, Presiding Officer, during previous exchanges in the Chamber, that I accept that the funding settlement creates challenges for colleges, but that's the reality we as a government are confronted by, and we are working hard to be as accommodating as we can be with the sector when it comes to flexibilities which help stabilise finances. As members have noted, the Scottish Government recently introduced legislation to add trade union nominees to college boards. This demonstrates the Government's commitment to ensure that the staff voice is reflected in college decision-making and secures good college governance. There is progress being made in this, but I would encourage those who have yet to do so, to continue to actively work together, that's the unions and the management, to achieve this important step forward. Because I believe genuinely that this has the potential to not only to improve governance at a local level, but to improve understanding of perspectives on the campuses. But I want to turn now to the issue of lessons learned, something that I noted earlier. I absolutely understand concerns about the frequency of industrial action in the college sector. Indeed, pretty much everyone I meet who's been involved in the negotiating process over the past decade will tell you it's in no one's interest for the approach which has come to characterise that process to continue. Everyone is, I think, frankly, scunnered with it. And I'm committed to facilitating the underlying issues being tackled. Fundamentally, Presiding Officer, is for college management and the trade unions to find a way to work more constructively. However, a few weeks ago I hosted a round table with all parties to look at the lessons learned report and to explore how we might turn the sentiments that are being expressed into tangible progress. And I was heartened to hear of a willingness to explore this, including potentially appointing an independent facilitator to try and move the SJNC process into a more constructive space. None of this is in the Scottish Government's gift to determine. We certainly could not impose it. It must be fully explored in partnership with employers and trade unions in order to ensure the national collective bargaining process is not undermined. But I do believe there's an opportunity here to move on from the near inevitability of annual industrial strife in the sector. And I want to conclude on that positive note and by once again encouraging employers and unions to do their utmost to resolve the current action. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.